Hello and welcome to New Filmmakers Los Angeles. We have a very, very exciting interview. I am delighted to have here Supinder and Renuka with their really incredible film. It's a digital series, The 410. It's amazing. I want to watch every episode, but for those that haven't seen it, here is a clip. I'm delighted to have you both here, and congratulations on the Thor 10. I'm obsessed, so you got to keep making more, like, all the time, please. How are you both doing?
Great. And actually, I'm in the middle of writing more episodes right now. And Renuka, I don't think I told you this, but I met with somebody earlier this afternoon for research purposes.
Wow.
So that's all I can say.
Live exclusives right in the middle. There we go. Oh, that's amazing. That's what we want to hear. I fell in love with the story. I fell in love with the characters. I really, really did. We're going to switch between you both because you obviously both took very powerful roles in making and creating this film. But Supinder, as the writer and the star of the film, where did the inspiration come for you in creating this project?
So the 410 is it's a three-part digital series, and it centers around an Indo-Canadian girl who's not really sure about where she fits in terms of her Indian heritage versus growing up in Canada. And her father, who's a truck driver, gets arrested for smuggling drugs across the Windsor-Detroit border, which forces her to move home to take care of her grandmother and confront her culture, her community, and also get into her father's world in terms of selling drugs to get him out of prison. The idea for the story came to me because Indo-Canadians being involved in the transport portion of the drug trade is actually not fiction. And a couple of years ago, I started seeing all these stories popping up when I was in film school, and I was fascinated by it. One, I mean, like, when it comes to stories about drugs and narcotics, like, people, we're just genuinely interested because they seem so far away from our world. Yeah. But for me, I actually come from a trucking family, so it seemed closer because my dad used to be a truck driver. I have uncles who are truck drivers. So these men that looked like my dad and my uncle being charged with this, it just felt like I knew their families, and it was a story that I really wanted to explore. Yeah. And I think for me personally, like, I've always wanted to play a bad character, or like a bad girl, and I never had that opportunity. So
you played it so well. You played it so well. I didn't even recognize you as the same person because I was like, you had this whole different energy and aura. I was like, you can't be the same person you played.
Only because I was so well directed.
There we go. So speaking of which, we have a dream team here. Renuka, you directed this, and you directed fantastically well. There were so many scenes in there, and I really did notice your great talent. So how did you get involved with the project with Supinder?
Well, Supinder and I have we're friends, but we've worked together before. She was in a short film that I directed a few years ago. And we stayed in touch, and she's just the loveliest person and so talented. And so when she told me she was, you know, writing this web series as a vehicle for herself as an actor and as a writer and a producer, I wanted to help in any way I could. And she wanted me to direct, which is good because I'm a director. And we just kind of became collaborators on the project, and that's kind of how I became a part of it.
I mean, the important thing is that we're still friends.
Yeah, it was always a good sign.
Pardon me?
That's always a good sign when you still friends afterwards.
What was a tough shoot? It was a really tough shoot because
So the first episode screened at the festival, but there's three episodes, all 25 minutes each, and we shot it all in 12 days, which is not a lot of time a lot of locations, a lot of unit moves, very small crew, very, you know, green and enthusiastic, but we, you know, we were all pitching in. We had long hours and tiring days, but yeah, we got it done.
It was amazing. I mean, I watch a lot of short film and I kept thinking, oh my goodness, another location, another scene. And this was just the one episode that you gave us. And I thought, what a challenge. So the fact you made that in that period of time is, I mean, you know, credit to you both and your team, because it was really brilliant. I love, Supinder, that this was actually kind of like, you know, you've come from, a background that has truck drivers in your family and center it around that. Because firstly, I don't think really people appreciate enough what truck drivers actually have to do and their jobs that they have to do. And it's nice that, you know, unfortunately, you know, there is this problem, with people getting into the wrong crowds or drug smuggling. And sometimes you wonder how even families get caught up in it. But, it, you know, once you kind of understand it more, you realize, unfortunately, this does happen, you know. And was it kind of something as well that you really kind of wanted your audience to sort of, you know, really know this is going on, and it also could be your family, you know, member or someone that you know? Did you kind of want to bring that perspective to this as well?
I don't think it was as altruistic as that, and I think that maybe the opposite, like what I want, like I don't think it was a PSA by any means. What I really wanted to do was actually normalize the flaws within the South Asian community, and not just within, you know, the drug trade, but I think also within like the relationship that Suri has with her father and the relationships between fathers and daughters, and also like addiction. And I think that it's really important for a community who doesn't really get to see themselves on screen that often, that instead of like, in terms of my personal career, I feel like I've played a lot of the model minority, a doctor or an accountant or a teacher. And I really, you know, I think I was joking when I said I wanted to play a bad character, but I think that I wasn't provided the opportunities to play those characters with flaws. Mm-hmm. And I think it's when we see our flaws represented in a way that isn't like, look at these terrible people. It's just like, this is a normal family that has issues, and these happen to be their particular issues. So that's what I want to do.
I'm glad that you said that as well. And I think it's important for people to really understand that there's a lot of dynamics to what was your character was experiencing, you know, and her relationship with her family, and also just how she's grown up to be, you know, a human being in the world, and how things have changed for her and where she is in her life. I thought you took us on an amazing journey with your character. It was really great. Renuka, like one of the things I was going to say to you that was so fascinating to me is, what is it like directing somebody else's piece they've written, and then also direct, you know, how are you as a director also in with your actors? Are you kind of quite hands-on? Do you let people play? How is that process for you?
I directing other people's work, I love, I direct my own writing, but I also love direct interpreting someone else's vision. Mm-hmm. So it's, and it was nice because the lead actor is also the creator. So we could really kind of collaborate and get to the nitty gritty of his character. So that wasn't a problem. It was really trying to get inside Supinder's brain, what she was trying to, the story she was trying to tell, and sort of taking, running with that. And in terms of working with actors, this is another thing I love. I love actors. I think they're so interesting. They're so different. Every actor is a different style, different process. I'm very collaborative. I listen a lot. I ask questions of the actors. And then I try to say as few words as possible, you know, mm-hmm. try to be very succinct. But really kind of pulling, I gravitate more towards the dynamics between characters and the emotions and those little beats. Mm-hmm. And when I watch movies, that resonate with me, like those, that twinkle in the eye, that thing that they're thinking, and you can just see it on screen. And so, trying to bring that out in some way.
And I want to add that Renuka's very hands-on as a director in the development process. Like in terms of writing the script, like we went through several passes of it, just the two of us, in terms of like really figuring out like the nuts and bolts of what was happening in each scene and why, and what was Suri doing. So I feel like correct me if I'm wrong, Renuka, but I feel like that is that part of your usual process in terms
yeah,
of...
Yeah, like if I haven't written it, I ask the writer a ton of questions, always asking what is, because if I don't understand it, I can't direct it. I can't interpret it. So everything Supinder knows, we'd have a 14-hour day once in the office, just me asking her, like going through the scenes, like, what is this? What do you mean here? Is this supposed to be funny? Is this supposed to, what is that? I don't get that. Like, really?
I don't know.
I just ask everything, because then I get, you know, the more you know, the better you can execute, so.
One of the things that, I thought, it, as well as obviously you, Supinder, but your whole cast were brilliant. Like every time you introduce a new character, I was like, you know, from your family members to your friends, it was just mesmerizing, because I really felt a strong story from everyone, that even their backstory, I felt it. You know, tell us a bit more about the casting process for you, because obviously from a writing perspective, from a director perspective, you have to kind of come together on finding your perfect cast to accompany you. Tell us a bit more about that.
Yeah, well, I think that being an actor in Canada for so long, I was just aware of all of the great actors from the South Asian community. So when it came to casting, I pretty much knew who everyone was going to be, and then it was just asking them. There was a few people, I mean, like the hardest person to cast was my father, just because South Asian males in that age range, there's not a lot of them. And I was very adamant that he needed to speak Punjabi, because I mean, India is such a vast country. So like, I know that in shows that I've done, I've been cast where I'm from the north and somebody from the south is playing my father. And if you're from India, you would know. If you're not, maybe you wouldn't. But I was adamant that that had to be accurate, that it had to be an actor from the north that would be from where I'm from to play my father. Funny story.
And the actor who plays her father, Malkeet, is not an actor. He's a businessman. He owns like shawarma shops, I think.
He has a bunch of shawarma franchises.
Yeah, he's never acted, never been on screen. So that was a new process for him.
An actor now. I mean, from the first shot, I was already involved in his character. It was like, boom, I'm there with him and what he gave us. So that's, there you go. You find new people too. That's amazing.
Yeah, he's
You're gonna share a story. You said you're gonna mention a story.
Oh well, we almost cast my dad, my actual dad.
See.
We were having such a tough time, but I think that the reason why we didn't, and like surprisingly, and like kudos to my dad, because he's actually a really good actor, but we didn't cast him because I was wearing so many hats, and I knew because it was my dad and I know him, like he wouldn't learn his lines. He'd just show up and be like, tell me what to do. And I was like, I can't deal with that. So.
Oh, wow. Well, one of the, you know, things that you briefly mentioned, but it did cross my mind, you know, when you're making a digital series and, you know, you're creating a show essentially, you know, when you start getting involved with more than one, how was the process for you in terms of production, and what were kind of some of the biggest challenges that maybe you faced either in pre-production, production or post-production? Because there was a lot of components, a lot of locations, a lot of places, and I felt for you all because I knew that it was a lot of work that went into it.
I'd say, yes, it was scheduling. You know, we didn't have a lot of days. And then there were some elements in the story that made it even harder. So one thing is, you know, episode one, the series, Supinder's character has blonde hair, which is a wig. But later, halfway through the series, she dyes her hair black. And so she's got a totally different hairstyle. But we were, you know, as you shoot, you're not shooting in chronological order. You're shooting all over the place. So there were days where we had to go back and forth between, you know, wig, no wig. And that was in pre-production, I remember huge, just lots of conversations about how logistically this is going to work. And so at one point we were like, should we even like do that transition of the hair? But it was so important to the character. Like, I know Supinder and myself really wanted to keep it. But that was one of the problematic.
Oh my God, yeah. At one point I was like, do I just dye my hair blonde? Like we were trying to figure out which one was easier to go back and forth with. Yeah. Also, there's a scene that takes place in the third episode, which you guys haven't seen yet, but it takes place in the Gurdwara, which is the Sikh temple. And I was really nervous about shooting there because there's a lot of rules in terms of, you know, you have to take off your shoes, you have to keep your head covered the entire time. But the most difficult part was just getting the yes from them to allow us to shoot in there. And I remember going in there with one of our producers, Eva Glavovic, who was lovely. And it was just the two of us, literally, like, in terms of a representation, like, just like we were sitting across from the patriarchy, all of these like older Sikh men. And I was terrified because I mean, of what our story is. And luckily they said yes, but that was one of the moments where, like, out of everything, I was so afraid to go into this Gurdwara and talk to these men.
Goodness, I'm so glad that you did. I'm so glad that you made it and did it. And just by the way, where can we see these other episodes? Where can we find them? Are they available for viewing yet?
Yeah, so they're streaming right now on CBC Gem. So Canadians can watch them. We don't have a US distributor right now, so it's only available in Canada, but maybe
we're gonna fly over to watch it, or we're gonna find you.
Canada's a great place. All of America should just come to Canada right now anyway.
Trust me, we're all thinking about it very much. One of the things that I love that you mentioned as well, I love that you mentioned that you just kind of wanted to just show, you know, family flaws, you know, and that they exist, and no, you know, and things go on in families. And I also love that you put an in focus on you know, the fact that there is limited of what we see from the South Asian community in Canada, and how that needs to be a continual improvement for what we see on our screens as well. And, you know, I commend you for just, you know, making a film that arises from those subjects and hopes to be part of, you know, the change and enhancement of what we see in our cinemas and our screens. Adding to that, like, what did you want your audience to take from your film? We certainly loved having your film at New Filmmakers and had a great experience, but what did you want your audience to take from your film away, or your series?
I would say I'm less, as a filmmaker, social issue driven. I kind of gravitate towards the characters because I personally, I think if I were to focus on those issues, it would be too didactic in my storytelling. So I kind of focus on the characters. But I just really want an audience to, you know, see this young woman that they haven't seen on screen before and see how empowered she is. And seeing different people on camera and into the popular culture is what we need more of. And if we put more out there, then maybe that'll have an effect and get even more stories told that are different.
Absolutely, absolutely. So Penny, do you have anything else to add to that?
Yeah, I think that just like, I mean, I made this show because this is the show that I would watch. Really, like I would want to watch like a crime story with somebody who looked like me at the heart of it. So I think in terms of taking anything away, I hope women my age and younger watch this and be like, oh, I can do that, or I can be that, or, you know, I don't have to be subservient, or I don't have to be quiet. Like I think that, like, growing up, I didn't see that. And yeah, I think that would be a cool takeaway, to just, like Renuka said, empower specifically young women who don't see themselves in roles of power on television that often.
And not to mention, I mean, you have some fantastic story and a fantastic story with a great cast that you want to see more of. Like, I was disappointed when the episode ended, because I really wanted more, and I wanted to experience more with your character and your family and all the unravelings that come with it. So that's always a good sign as well, in your storytelling. Just finally, you are, you know, I really love speaking with you both, because you both are so, you know, naturally inspirational. I would love if there is any advice that each of you could kind of share for any filmmaker out there, because I really feel that both of you are just filmmakers that get it over the line, that make it happen, that do it. And is there anything out there, people that just think, wow, I wish I could do what you both do? Do you have any advice for them? Anything maybe you've been told, or something you go by in your filmmaking worlds?
I would say, you know, you want to make the most of every opportunity that comes your way, but sometimes those opportunities don't come your way. And so make your own opportunity. Just, you know, go make a film, make it on your phone, write a, like, you can take it, you can be a writer and, like, you don't need any crew, any production stuff. You just need, you know, a paper and a pen. Tell your stories in any, by any means necessary, in any way possible. Don't take no for an answer. I think just keep going and don't be discouraged, because there's a lot of lows in this industry, a lot of failures, a lot of rejections. But you just need to, if the only way it won't work is if you give up. So just don't give up.
Thank you,
Ryan. I have the exact same advice. I think that, like, it sometimes surprised me that the 410 has done so well. And it literally started with, I think a while ago, it was just this like germ of an idea that I had, like the tiniest little thing. And I was like, I wonder if, I think that just following that if, and then now we're here. And I don't think I did anything different than what Renuka just described. That's it.
Amazing. Well, just please just keep making more. We need you, please. I'm almost begging right now at this point, because honestly, I love your story and your vision, and I love the work you put out there. And so we're very excited for you. But thank you for bringing your digital series, The New Filmmakers. We'll have it up where you can see at the bottom where to catch them if you're in Canada. But it's worth the flight over to watch the film anyway. So, you know, I might just get a flight to Canada just so I can see it, okay?
Thank you to you guys. Like, yeah. I think these opportunities help filmmakers like us to grow and learn and to expand our networks. And I think that's the other thing that you can do if you don't have a project yet, is to attend things like this so you get better at the craft.
Oh, thank you. Well, we can't do it without your film, so we appreciate it. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Danny.
Thank you.